Welcome to worship. I do have one announcement in particular, and that is Hands on Mission will meet after the service on Sunday, this coming Sunday, July 26th, in the library, or if enough people show up, it'll be out there in the gathering space or possibly outside, depending on how many people would like to go and join Hands on Mission. They're looking at what they can do to be reaching out to our congregation as well as possibly the community. Let's see. I see that the cemetery also has a note in there. So please, you know, this is back there on that the table by the offering box, and these are for you to take home if you so choose. So please do that. Also, I see here it says save the date. The Valder's Lions Club and Fire Department is going to have a brat and burger fry on Saturday, August 1st in our parking lot. So the lower parking lot. So please take note of that as well. Are there any other announcements that need to be made? We certainly want to welcome you and also anyone watching online or on TV as we gather for worship. Let us stand. We begin our worship in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Our call to worship is from Psalm 119. How can a young person stay on the path of purity? By living according to your word. I seek you with all my heart. Do not let me stray from your commands. Hide God's word in your heart so that you may not sin against him. Praise be to you, O Lord. Teach me your decrees. With our lips may we recount all the laws that come from the Lord. I rejoice in following your statutes as one rejoices in great riches. May we meditate on God's precepts and consider his ways. I delight in your decrees. I will not neglect your word. May we take an oath and confirm it that we will follow God's righteous laws. Your word is a lamp for my feet and a light upon my path. Let's, if you have your mask on, you're welcome to sing along with our opening hymn, which is God's Word is Our Great Heritage. To spread its light from age to age shall be our chief endeavor. Through life it guides our way, in death it is our stay. Lord, grant while time shall last, your church may hold it fast throughout all generations. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all. Let us pray. O Lord God, you speak to us through the Holy Scriptures. Grant that we may hear, read, respect, learn, and make them our own in such a way that the enduring benefit and comfort of the Word will help us to grasp and hold the blessed hope of everlasting life given us through our Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. You may be seated, and we have our scriptures read for this evening.
The first reading is written in the 55th chapter of Isaiah. Seek the Lord while he may be found. call on him while he is near. Let the wicked forsake their ways and the unrighteous their thoughts. Let them turn to the Lord, and he will have mercy on them, and to our God, for he will freely pardon. For my thoughts are not your thoughts, neither are your ways my ways, declares the Lord. As the heavens are higher than the earth, so are my ways higher than your ways, and my thoughts than your thoughts. As the rain and the snow come down from heaven and do not return to it without watering the earth and making it bud and flourish, so that it yields seed for the sower and bread for the eater, so is my word that goes out from my mouth. It will not return to me empty, but will accomplish what I desire and achieve the purpose for which I sent it, the word of the Lord. The second reading is written in the third chapter of 2 Timothy. But as for you, continue in what you have learned and have become convinced of, because you know those from whom you learned it and how from infancy you have known the Holy Scriptures, which are able to make you wise for salvation through faith in Christ Jesus. All Scripture is God-breathed and is useful for teaching, rebuking, correcting, and training in righteousness, so that the servant of God may be thoroughly equipped for every good work. In the presence of God and of Christ Jesus, who will judge the living and the dead, and in view of his appearing and his kingdom, I give you this charge. Preach the word, be prepared in season and out of season. Correct, rebuke, and encourage with great patience and careful instruction. For the time will come when people will not put up with sound doctrine. Instead, to suit their own desires, they will gather around them a great number of teachers to say what their itching ears want to hear. The word of the Lord.
Please stand for the reading of the gospel. The Holy Gospel according to St. Matthew, the 7th chapter. This is at the end of the Sermon on the Mount. Jesus has given all of his teachings, kind of explaining the law and what God wants from us, teaching about prayer, about how we live our lives. And he closes with these words. Not everyone who says to me, Lord, Lord, will enter the kingdom of heaven, but only the one who does the will of my Father who is in heaven. Many will say to me on that day, Lord, Lord, did we not prophesy in your name? And in your name drive out demons, and in your name perform many miracles. Then I will tell them plainly, I never knew you. Away from me, you evildoers. Therefore, everyone who hears these words of mine and puts them into practice is like a wise man who built his house on the rock. The rain came down, the streams rose, and the winds blew and beat against that house. Yet it did not fall, because it had its foundation on the rock. But everyone who hears these words of mine and does not put them into practice is like a foolish man who built his house on sand. The rain came down, the streams rose, and the winds blew and beat against that house, and it fell with a great crash. When Jesus had finished saying these things, the crowds were amazed at his teaching, because he taught as one who had authority and not as the teachers of the law. The gospel of our Lord. Praise to you, O Christ. You may be seated. Well, I've been doing a message series on Christianity 101, kind of a back to basics, and tonight it's God's Word. And Jesus finishes the Sermon on the Mount where he's really teaching about God's Word, explaining what God really wants. God wants a heart, not just somebody who technically is trying to keep the law, but God wants the heart of the human, the being, our inner being. And so he says, everyone who hears these words of mine and puts them into practice is like the wise man who built his house on the rock. What is the foundation on which our lives are built? Jesus teaches about how to live in relationship with God and with one another. That's what the Sermon on the Mount is all about. That's what so much of Jesus' teachings are about. This is what he teaches his disciples, his closest followers. In John chapter 13, at the beginning of the Last Supper, it says that Jesus took the bowl, wrapped a towel around his waist, and washed the feet of the disciples because no one else did. And it says, when he had finished washing their feet, he put on his clothes and returned to his place. "Do you understand what I have done for you?" he asked. "You call me teacher and Lord, and rightly so, for that is what I am. Now that I, your Lord and teacher, have washed your feet, you also should wash one another's feet. I have set you an example that you should wash one another's feet to do as I have done for you. For very truly I tell you, no servant is greater than his master, no messenger is greater than the one who sent him. Now that you know these things, you will be blessed if you do them." Again, Jesus talks about the blessing of putting his words into practice. "Love one another," Jesus said, "as I have loved you. By this everyone will know that you are my disciples, if you love one another. Put my teachings into practice, and you will be blessed." In the gospel, in the letter of James, actually James was Jesus' brother, younger brother, who became a leader in the church, especially in Jerusalem. And he wrote a letter, and in the first chapter he says, "Do not merely listen to the word and so deceive yourselves. Do what it says. Anyone who listens to the word but does not do what it says is like the one who looks at his face in a mirror. After looking at himself, he goes away and immediately forgets what he looks like. But whoever looks intently into the perfect law that gives freedom and continues in it, not forgetting what they have heard, but doing it, they will be blessed in what they do." Again, a blessing. Living out the life that God has for us, the teachings of Jesus, the teachings of the Bible. This is my first point. It is not just about reading it, but believing it is God's word. God's word. Not just words from people about God, but God through people, through the prophets, through the apostles, inspired by the Holy Spirit, speaking his word. Luther wrote, he said, "If only we believed that God is speaking to us and that whatever we read or hear in the Bible is God's word, you would find and feel that it is not read or heard in vain, and we would embrace it." Embrace it and live it. The Bible, the scriptures, are God's love letters to humanity, it's been said. And truly they are. I mean, it's how God wants to reach out and help people to understand what life is all about, living in relationship with God and with one another. It is filled with truth and wisdom for living, and yes, commands, but also promises. This is God's word to us. What more could you ask of a parent? Isn't it to guide, to give wisdom? Yes, sometimes it's commands. It's telling our sons or daughter what they need to do. And sometimes there are consequences when you don't follow through. But there are always promises. There's the love, the things that we want to do for our kids. Our son Christopher went off to college, actually down in Texas, at the University of North Texas. And one of the things that happened was through the course of time, through work, there was a man there and invited him to come and live with them in their house. And he only had to pay like, I figure it was like $100 or $200 a month for rent, which was a lot cheaper than living on campus or different places. And so all he had to do was help take care of his children. Because he and his wife oftentimes were busy working and so on and so forth. And so he did. And I remember he said to me once, he said, Dad, I never appreciated how much you and Mom put into raising us as children till I lived with that family. Because sometimes that's the challenge, that they haven't had, if you will, the same kind of upbringing, of teaching, of holding accountable, and so forth, that we need as people, and that we need to provide as parents, and that God provides. You see, that's part of God's love. God shows us the way, but also sometimes holds us accountable for the way we live, as a loving parent will do. And so this is my second point, and that is the Bible is the inspired Word of God and the authoritative source and norm for faith and life. Do you know where that comes from? The constitution of our denomination and the constitution of this church. It's what we believe. It's what we hold sacred. The Bible is the inspired Word of God and the authoritative source and norm for faith and life. That it's the scriptures that are the authority. That's what the Reformation was about. What is the true final authority in all matters of faith and life? And Luther and the Reformers said, it is Scripture. That councils and popes and bishops can err, but the Word of God does not. Faith is our knowledge and understanding, our worldview, the way we see things. It's our foundation for how we see and understand the world and how we should live in it. It forms the foundation for how we live our lives as Christians. Do we value the Scriptures as God's Word? Do we read it, learn from it, and put it into practice? We heard in Isaiah chapter 55, "For my thoughts are not your thoughts, neither are my ways your ways, declares the Lord. As the heavens are high above the earth, so are my ways higher than your ways, and my thoughts higher than your thoughts." We need to learn from God. Do we value the Scriptures more than any other writings and things that we can learn? That they are the Word of God. It's what God wants to show us about life, about the world, about everything. When Jesus was being challenged in the Gospel of John, at one time the Jews were angry and some were going away, even some of the believers said, you know, some of your sayings are hard. And Jesus turned to his disciples, would you go also? And Peter says, Lord, to whom shall we go? You have the words of eternal life. We have come to believe and to know that you are the Holy One of God. You see, putting your trust and your hope in that one. Jesus, when he was away with his closest disciples, said, who do people say that I am? And some are saying that you're John the Baptist come back, or Elijah come, or one of the great prophets. And Jesus said, but who do you say that I am? And Peter makes the good confession. You are the Messiah, the Son of the living God. And Jesus said, flesh and blood has not shown you this, but my Father in heaven. This is my third point. Jesus Christ is the Word of God in the flesh. Jesus is the living Word of God. Jesus Christ is the Word of God in the flesh. Jesus is the living Word of God. It's one thing to be able to read about someone, but it's totally different to actually get to know the person one-on-one. That's what we see the disciples doing with Jesus. And they share those stories. They share those teachings. They share who he was. John, the Apostle John, writes in his first chapter, he says, the Word became flesh and made his dwelling amongst us. We have seen his glory, the glory of the one and only Son who came from the Father, full of grace and truth. The law was given through Moses, but grace and truth came through Jesus Christ. I was reading a devotion the other day, and it was a devotion that was by Dr. Dobson. Maybe you're familiar with him, but he talked about his grandparents. And his grandparents had kind of an ongoing thing throughout their relationship together, their married life. And that is they would hide someplace or put it different places. S-H-M-I-L-Y, Schmiley. Well, he shared about how they would, the different places they'd put it in the house or different, you know, and all this. And he said, at the end he says, and then I learned what Schmiley meant. S-H-M-I-L-Y, see how much I love you. See, that's what God has shown us in Christ. See how much I love you? For God so loved the world that he sent his only son. See, it began with Abraham. I talked about that, the old covenant, the covenant with Abraham. But part of the covenant with Abraham was, I want to bless the whole world through you. Jesus is a descendant of Abraham. It continues through Moses, through the law, which becomes the guide for them. This is the way I want to live with you as my people. This is the way you should live and reflect my love. Loving not only God, seek me and love me with all your heart, but love your neighbor as yourself. God revealing his will for his people, Israel, but also for all of humanity. And so this is my fourth point, and that is both law and gospel are the word of God, revealing the justice, the mercy, and the love of God, beginning with the word in creation and continuing through the history of Israel and centering in all its fullness in the person and work of Jesus Christ. That's where we see the gospel, the promises kept, that he calls us to be his people, not only in this life, but onto eternal life. The good news, the gift of grace, of forgiveness, of eternal life, and of his spirit. Law helps us see how to live. But our lower nature, our flesh, we can't live it out rightly. And so it is that Christ came to be that atoning sacrifice, that we are forgiven for his sake. Knowing right from wrong isn't the same as being able to do it. And so we see our failings through the law. We see our sins, our lack of love. But the gospel is God's promise of love and forgiveness. The Mosaic Law was given to the people of Israel to guide them through. This is how you will be my people. But the new covenant is living by the Spirit of God and living in Christ, and it is for the whole world. This is the new covenant. And so my fifth point is that the Old and New Testaments, or Old and New Covenants, are the written word of God, inspired by God's Spirit, speaking through the authors, the priests, the prophets, and the apostles. As we heard in 2 Timothy chapter 3, all scripture is God-breathed, useful for teaching, rebuking, correcting, and training in righteousness, so that the servant of God may be thoroughly equipped for every good work. Scriptures. As I said, that part of the Reformation was that these scriptures are the authority for the people of God, for the Christian church. But at the time of the Reformers, the time of Luther, that the scriptures were only in Latin, that the common people didn't know and understand them. And the Reformers risked their lives to translate it into the language of the people. There were people like John Huss or Wycliffe that were burned at the stake for translating the scriptures into the common language. But we have them. We've won that battle, so to speak. Why did they risk their lives? Because they believed in the truth and the power of the scriptures to change lives, to help us be to God's people. Jesus is the center of all of scripture, old and new. You see, we only see and truly understand what God was doing from day one until we look back and we see it through the eyes, the life of Jesus Christ, how God was working through Abraham, through Moses, through David, through Isaiah, through Jeremiah, throughout history. We can look back like the apostles did and see Christ throughout the whole Old Testament, the promise, the hope that we have. And so this is my next point, number 6. The Scriptures call us to a life of faith and love, inspired by the Holy Spirit. Just like the writers of the Bible were inspired by the Holy Spirit to write the things they did. That's why we call it the God's Word. But also, we need that inspiration. We need the Holy Spirit, like I talked about last week. We need the Holy Spirit as the sanctifier to help us live those lives. But we need the Scriptures. We need to know them. Luther said that when children are old enough to grasp the concepts of faith, we should give them the Scriptures to learn and know. He said, you can put in the Scriptures about faith in a golden pouch. He said, Scriptures like Romans chapter 10. If you declare with your mouth Jesus is Lord and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you will be saved. For with your heart you have believed and are justified, and it is with your mouth that you profess your faith and are saved. These are golden Scriptures. He said, let there be a pouch of silver for love, with verses like Matthew chapter 7. So in everything, do to others what you would want done for you. For this sums up all the law and the prophets. He continued, no one should look down on this as child's play. If we want to train our children, then we must show them the way. If we do, in a short time, we would see an abundance of Christian people rich in Scripture. More than enough has been written in books, but not enough has been driven into our hearts. See, that's where God wants his word to be, hidden away in our hearts. Scripture verses should be kept where? In our heart, in our mind, as we live it out. Our son, Andrew, struggled with doing math homework. When he was in middle school, they had taught him, you know, make this lattice and and finally I got frustrated doing homework with him. I said, Andrew, we are going to memorize your multiplication and division tables. And we did. You know, sometimes if you know the things, then you can begin to do it in your head. In the same way, if we know Scripture, if we memorize it, if we can think about it, then we can live it out. Scriptures answers the key religious questions. Where does this world come from? Where is the universe and the very gift of life from? It is from God. What is the meaning and purpose of life, human life, my life? And it is love. It's living in relationships, loving relationships with God and with one another. What is right and what is wrong? Morality, ethics, how should we live? Again, it's love. That's what God calls us to. Is there life after death? How do we get there? That's the gospel. Yes, Jesus rose from the dead, and all who believe in him are justified by faith. How do I know this is true? It is not that God's word has been tried and found deficient or lacking. It has not been lived. It is a leap of faith, a step into God's kingdom. When Jesus said to his disciples, come, follow me, they had to take that step. They had to follow. Let me ask you, is this apple sweet or tart? Is it soft or is it mushy? How do you know? A little bit of tartness and crisp. It's a Honeycrisp, my favorite. You see, As you taste it, you see that it's good. In Psalm 34, it says, "Taste and see that the Lord is good. Blessed is he who takes refuge in the Lord." How many of you ever picked a watermelon? Thump? How do you do it? Look at the color? But how do you really know that it's sweet and good? You get home, you cut it, and you take your first piece, and then you know. You see, as you step into it, as you live it, you discover that it's true, it's powerful, it's good. The Holy Spirit is calling us through the gospel, living by faith and guided by Scripture and God's Spirit. That's the way we're called to live as God's people, as Christians, as people living in Christ. Amen. Holy words long preserved for our walk in this world. They resound with God's own heart. Let the ancient words impart. Ancient words ever true, changing me, changing you. May we come with open hearts. Ancient words impart. Amen. Let us watch and listen to ancient words.
Ancient words will guide us all.
Please stand. Let us affirm our faith together in the God that calls us through his Son, Jesus Christ, and enlightens our minds, empowers us for ministry, and keeps us in true faith through his Holy Spirit. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Now let us lift up our hearts in prayer, our prayers of intercession. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, you have blessed us with the joy and care of children. As we bring them up, give fathers and mothers calm strength and patient wisdom so that they may teach them to love what is true and good, following the example of our Lord Jesus. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We lift up God's creation, the seas and the creatures that live in them, for the lands of the earth, all creatures, vegetation, and the crops of farmers. May we be good stewards of all that you have placed under our care. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Lord God, you are our peace and strength. We pray for our nation. Protect the most vulnerable among us. Grant wisdom, patience, and clarity of mind to our leaders as they seek more just ways for our society. Guide us as we consider how best to respond within our families, workplaces, neighborhoods, and communities. Give us courage to face these days not with fear but with compassion, graciousness, and respect for all people. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Gracious Heavenly Father, we pray for your whole church on earth. Fill us with your spirit of truth and love. May we cherish, honor, and keep your word. Where we have sinned, purify us. Where we are in error, correct us. Where your body is divided, Lord Jesus, reunite us in your peace, we pray. May our witness to you be beacons of light for the communities which we serve. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. And Lord, we also lift up those for whom we carry concern in our hearts this day. We pray for your healing and comforting touch for Dennis Evenson, Ron Jones, Ray Kyle, Larry Madsen, Rose Benke, Ginger Linsmeyer, Bob Klesick, Janice Burkhart, Bernadette Thompson, Nathan Lehman, John Ryan, Betty Pritzel, Merle Graff, Sue Bellin, and Wayne Allen Husky. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We also lift up those who are serving in the military, Darcy Bachneck, Daniel Brandel, Kyle and Dylan Conrad, Corey Evenson, Mitchell Hazelwood, Carter Hildebrandt, Gary Hildebrandt, Jeff Kahns, Justin Mertzig, Chad Pohl, Stephen Schmoody, and Andy Schnell. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. In the name of your Son, Jesus Christ, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Now let us pray together the prayer by which our Lord taught us to pray, our Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, now and forever. Amen. May the Lord bless you and keep you. May he make his face to shine upon you and be gracious to you. May he look upon you with his favor and give you his joy, his peace, and his love. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. You may be seated. Our closing song is the prayer.
I pray you'll be all right and watch us where we go and help us to be wise in times when we don't know.
Go in the Spirit of Christ and love and serve the Lord, sharing God's word, showing God's love, and serving God's world. Amen. Thank you for coming.